there. Welcome to Jamaica Magazine. I'm Sandra Clark. Between the pages today, we talk hurricane preparation. But being hungry during a hurricane is no joke. Therefore, food is also being served. We have that and so much more. This is the show with the information you need to know. So stay with us as we turn the pages.
Want to know the law pertaining to renting a house? What about the procedure if you're arrested? Or what is defined as corruption? Then click on the Ministry of Justice website. It has information on every law passed in Jamaica. The House of Parliament portal also has the more recent year's pieces of legislation. The sites are easy to search and the files are downloadable. Make access to justice your business. Know your rights. Good day, I'm Lorraine Mendez, and this is your JIS News for Tuesday, June 18. The Ministry of Science, Energy and Technology is being guided by the Attorney General's Chambers on steps to address legal developments in the compulsory acquisition of the Venezuelan government's previous 49% shares in Petrojam. In a release, Portfolio Minister Favel Williams says a letter was received from a law firm representing the Venezuelan oil subsidiary PDV Carib. This was forwarded to the Attorney General's office. Following approval in the House of Representatives, the Senate approved legislation to retake ownership of PDV Carib's shares in Petrojam on February 22. The government's decision was in a bid to safeguard the country's energy security. It was also reinforced by years of inaction by PDV Carib to upgrade and expand the oil refinery, which formed part of a joint venture agreement in the sale of Petrojam shares in August 2006 and February 2007. Prime Minister Andrew Holness says designs have begun for the construction of a pier in Port Royal. This investment is to support the preservation of artifacts from the sunken city and increase economic activities within Kingston.
It will become a port of call for cruise ships to once again come into the port of Kingston. We will return the ferry system from Port Royal into Kingston. It will mean greater employment for the people who live in that area, and we will be able to have economic benefit from our history.
Prime Minister Holness was addressing the opening ceremony for the 8th Biennial Jamaica Diaspora Conference on Sunday. He told the Jamaicans living overseas that the build-out of roadworks across the corporate area would support this increase in economic activities. It's part of a strategic move to position Kingston as the Caribbean's center for trade, commerce, art, culture, and entertainment. And speaking at the same function, President of the Republic of Ghana, Nana Akufo-Addo, asserted that human capital must be the driving force of economic and social development if nations are to achieve self-reliance. He said aspired levels of development could not be achieved solely by aid or external assistance, no matter how generous.
It is a mindset that I wish us to discuss, to discard, a mindset of dependency and living on handouts, which are unhealthy both for the giver and for the recipient.
President Akufo-Addo said African countries had come a long way from that aid dependence status and were on their way to building robust economies that would propel them into the ranks of developed nations. Also coming out of the conference, Foreign Affairs Minister Senator Kamina Johnson Smith says a Global Diaspora Council will be established to provide the institutional framework for a more organized and expanded Jamaica Diaspora Organization. She says this will create a wider membership of Jamaicans.
This widened group, this proposed group of the Diaspora Council, will not only ease the burden placed on a few who now carry the weight of the board, but it will allow for greater inclusivity.
The Foreign Affairs Minister was speaking at the first plenary session of the 2019 conference on Monday. In an update from the Diaspora Advisory Board meeting held on Sunday, she said representation would be made from six regions for appointment on the board. Three newly retrofitted ambulances costing just under $31 million were handed over to the Percy Junor Hospital in Mandeville recently. The Regional Health Authority converted three new buses into the ambulances, which resulted in savings of over $10 million. This increases the number of units in the Southern Regional Health Authority to 14.
You know, when it comes to saving lives, the mobility, the logistics of the process, separate and apart from the expertise of doctors and nurses, is very, very critical.
Each vehicle is equipped with heart monitor, suction and ECG machines, double nurses' seats, stretcher, cupboards to store vital medical equipment, and other vital amenities. The ambulances are expected to give at least 10 good years of service. And finally, Jamaicans continue to honor former Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Edward Siaga's legacy at a football festival on Sunday. Held at the Edward Siaga Sports Complex, the tournament featured past and present players of the Tivoli Gardens Football Club, which was founded by the late constituency representative.
It was a very well set up, all-star set up to represent the life and passing of Mr. Edward Siaga, you know, the past players of Tivoli Garden, and as you can see, neighboring community at Arnett Garden, you know, national players, representative, even having the coach there though with me here. So it was totally a bunch of entertainment and love in regards to all Mr. Edward Siaga loved the sports of football and sports in regards to everything.
The Tivoli All-Stars suffered a 1-0 loss to the Premier League Clubs Association team, while the Tivoli Under-20 team settled for a 1-1 draw with Kasafa. The Tivoli Under-17 team was, however, victorious, beating Santos FC 3-0. Celebratory activities continue on Wednesday with a revival table at the Tivoli Gardens Community Centre and a joint sitting of the Houses of Parliament, as well as a setup at Tivoli Gardens Square on Saturday. And that's it for JIS News today. I'm Lorraine Mendez. Thank you for watching.
Up next, the latest happenings out of the office of the Prime Minister.
Prime Minister Andrew Holness prepares Jamaica for the fourth industrial revolution, secures visa waiver for Jamaicans traveling to Ghana, and welcomes Kingston's newest hotel and conference room. You're watching Jamaica House Weekly. I'm Anthony Morgan. For a few days last week, the Prime Minister was representing Jamaica's interests in Geneva, Switzerland. On Wednesday morning, he gave the keynote address at the 108th session of the International Labour Conference, held in observation of the centenary of the International Labour Organization. Prime Minister Andrew Holness addressed the gathering under the theme, Advancing Social Justice, Promoting Decent Work.
We are committed to the decent work agenda through empowering our citizens with education and training to make them marketable, employable, and productive in a competitive labor market and economy.
Mr. Holness told delegates that the country was making significant investments in human capital as it prepares for the fourth industrial revolution. He asserted that while the country was embracing sweeping technological advances, the dignity of labor would be preserved and protected. This, the Prime Minister said, was being done through initiatives such as the HOPE program, the Jamaica National Service Corps, and the Career Advancement Program.
We understand that we must upskill our labor force and make the investments in creating our digital and knowledge society to compete effectively for the jobs of the future. We recognize that there is much more to be done for the Jamaican worker. However, much progress is being made within a cooperative and collaborative framework of social consensus building and respect for the human element as the center of the social contract for development.
While in Switzerland, the Prime Minister met with the Director General of the United Nations Office in Geneva, Michael Moller. He stressed the importance of strategic development planning as seen in the island's Vision 2030 National Development Framework. Director General Moller used the meeting to welcome Mr. Holness's appointment as co-chair of the UN Climate Initiative to raise funds for climate financing by 2020. The Prime Minister also met with the Director General of the World Trade Organization, Roberto Azevedo. Talks focused on the digital economy and trade. And Prime Minister Holness closed out his working visit to Switzerland by engaging the Jamaican diaspora and diplomatic community.
And I believe that this will elevate Kingston as a destination and Jamaica generally. So I'm very pleased. I'm very pleased.
That was Prime Minister Andrew Holness back in the island and touring of the newly opened AC Marriott Hotel on Lady Musgrave Road. The $55 million US dollar joint venture between the Marriott and Sandals International Groups boasts 220 rooms, a conference center, gym, restaurant, and poolside deck. Mr. Holness expressed satisfaction that of the 220 staff employed to the hotel, 219 were Jamaicans.
The kinds of investment that we are promoting are investments that fulfill the social contract of, yes, creating economic opportunities, but also creating economic development for people, placing people at the center of the development. And so all in all, I think everyone wins with this kind of development.
On Saturday, Prime Minister Holness welcomed President of Ghana, Nana Addo Dankwa Akufo-Addo, to the island. Following President Akufo-Addo's signing of a condolence book for former Prime Minister Edward Siaga, he and Prime Minister Holness engaged in a courtesy call, followed by a working luncheon. During a joint media briefing, it was revealed that starting July 1, Ghana will waive visa requirements for Jamaicans to enter that country.
The Ghana-Jamaica Joint Commission for Cooperation that has been dormant for some time is going to be reactivated, hopefully this year, if not as quick, as early as possible in the first quarter of next year, so that the various areas of engagement that we're talking about can be properly structured within a legal framework for the doing of business between our two countries.
Our discussions also focused on important bilateral matters, and in particular, measures to improve trade and investments and the movement of people, goods, and services between our two countries.
President Akufo-Addo was on the island for a two-day working visit to promote his country's Year of Return 2019. The president's engagement included a visit with Governor General Sir Patrick Allen, a floral tribute at the shrine of national hero Marcus Garvey, and before his departure on Sunday, the president addressed the opening of the 2019 Jamaica Diaspora Conference at the Jamaica Pegasus Hotel. The prime minister also addressed Sunday's opening of the 2019 staging of the Jamaica Diaspora Conference. He updated the gathering on plans for the redevelopment of Port Royal. Mr. Holness said the designs for the construction of a pier at the sunken city were being finalized.
Become a port of call for cruise ships to once again come into the port of Kingston. We will return the ferry system from Port Royal into Kingston. It will mean greater employment for the people who live in that area, and we will be able to have economic benefit from our history.
And on Sunday, the Prime Minister attended a Father's Day picnic on the lawns of Jamaica House. Held under the theme, Furthering Families with Fathers, Mr. Holness called on fathers to become more involved in their children's lives. He made a special appeal to fathers of male children.
I want our fathers to recommit to taking a greater role in the lives of their boys, in ensuring that they don't deviate from that right path, that they don't make the mistakes that you made in your life, that you hold their hands and guide them along the path of success. Don't give up on them. Don't give up on them.
And that's how we close out Jamaica House Weekly. Be sure to join us next time for more news stories coming out of the Office of the Prime Minister.
Want a hurricane or tropical storm to reach Jamaica, but the truth is we're within the hurricane season, so that is entirely possible. It means preparation is key. Watch this next feature to find out about some of the projects unfolding across the country to get the island ready should a tropical system strike.
Jamaica, based on its location in the Caribbean Basin, is at a position
that is vulnerable to the eventualities of a hurricane season. Basically, we are expecting a normal, near normal season. It could go a little above, it could go a little before. What we are projecting is that we will see somewhere between 9 and 15 tropical storms developing. 4 to 8 of these will become hurricanes. That's what is expected. And out of those, we could see 2 to 4 being major hurricanes, meaning they will reach category 3, 4, or 5, creating significant catastrophic damage to the island's infrastructure. We really just have to prepare ourselves for anything that could happen. And these are the numbers that we see here.
The National Works Agency's preparation for the 2019 Atlantic hurricane season has been ongoing. This is evident in the nature and scope of works that the agency has been undertaking island-wide over the last year or more. Just recently, approval was granted for the commencement of works under the GOJ's 2019 Pre-Hurricane Mitigation Program. This involves primarily drain cleaning and debushing activities. The program is the first and one of three routine drain cleaning activities which the NAA will undertake during this hurricane season. The agency will carry out maintenance on our drain network during the course of the upcoming 6 months. And as I said earlier, we'll do it in three tranches. A total of $99.5 million have been allocated amongst MPs to undertake works in relation to the unclogging of drains and the desilting of channels where their constituents live, work, play, or do business. Where our major projects are concerned, the focus is more on improving existing drainage features as well as having new ones constructed. Extensive drainage improvement works are being or have been carried out along the Mandela Highway, Barbican Road, Hagley Park, Camp Road, work is also taking place there, Constant Spring Road, as well as along the 12.6 kilometer stretch from Ferris to Macfield over in Westmoreland.
ODPEM, as Jamaica's disaster agency, is the heartbeat of our efforts. I urge every Jamaican to pay close attention to its messages and act in accordance with them. The warnings and encouragements to prepare and to better manage our immediate environment should not be seen as a nuisance.
We wish ourselves the best. We wish all of you the best. We wish our Caribbean neighbors the best. As we go through this hurricane season, all of us are vulnerable and all of us need to watch each other's back.
When you're on the road, take your time. When you're on the road, bear this in mind. When you're on the road, you could save a life when you're on the road.
The late former Prime Minister Edward Seaga will be laid to rest on Sunday. The latter part of this week is the official period of mourning. Next, guidelines and protocols to be followed during this time of bereavement.
June 19 to June 22nd will be declared the official period of mourning.
This official period of mourning for former Prime Minister Edward Seaga is in keeping with government protocols for such an event to show respect for a recently deceased head of state or government, a former head of state, or a national figure. Certain guidelines are to be followed during the 4-day period.
Flags to be flown at half-mast.
The half-mast position is approximately the short side of the flag below the peak of the flagpole and not halfway down the mast. The flag should first be hoisted close up and then lowered to the half-mast position. This must be adhered to on all public buildings. During the period of mourning, no public social function or official event should be held. It is customary during an official period of mourning to curtail activity of a flamboyant or celebratory nature and restrict especially any activity that is noisy. Sedate colors and modest attire are suggested during a period of state mourning. It is tradition that men wearing neckties should select black, dark blue, or other dark conservative colors with subdued patterns. Ladies should dress appropriately with corresponding conservative colors. The four-day period of mourning in honor of the life and service of the Most Honorable Edward Seaga will precede his state funeral. It will be held on Sunday, June 23, beginning at noon at the Cathedral of the Most Holy Trinity on North Street in Kingston. Interment will follow at the National Heroes Park.
As the United Nations observes Sustainable Gastronomy Day, we take a look back at the occasion of Devon House being designated as the Gastronomy Center of Jamaica.
This evening we launch the first of hopefully a number of gastronomy centers across Destination Jamaica. We selected Devon House to be the start, not only because it is unique in its own offerings, we also selected Devon House because it's in the center of commerce and entertainment and culture in the Caribbean, the city of Kingston.
Gastronomy is one of the fastest growing reasons for people to travel. The World Tourism Organization estimates that the gastronomy market is approximately $150 billion. Boasting world-renowned food and beverage delights such as ackee and saltfish, jerk pork, coffee, and rum, Jamaica is being marketed as a food destination. The tourism ministry is serving a platter of treats to foodies. Serving the helpings are Gastronomy Centers of Jamaica, stops for guests to cook, dine, and be educated on Jamaican food.
We're going to be establishing here at Devon House the first gastronomy club. And we will be building a special kitchen so that that dream of putting the first standalone kitchen without a chef, without a cook, without anyone except those who will see to its campness throughout the period. And we will be marketing that kitchen as a location for visitors from across the world to come to Devon House and cook. So you will bring your families on a Sunday afternoon, and we'll be establishing a farmer's market just next door to it. The final thing that we want to do here at Devon House in advancing this gastronomy prototype is to establish a food shop. You move from shop to shop and you just nibble. You just pick and eat different types of cuisine. So you perhaps start with a little rundown. The next shop is jerk chicken. The next shop is jerk pork. The next shop is ackee and saltfish.
It seems a perfect combo. Devon House, built by Jamaica's first black millionaire in the 1800s, has transcended into a haven for ice cream lovers and socialites. Already on site, some 14 eateries featuring local and international cuisine.
I think it's an excellent idea. I think the time has come for that. We serve both Jamaican food, international food, and we also have an Italian pizzeria.
What we do is a thin crust pizza with fresh dough, daily prepared. And we combine it with the Jamaican flavor. So like the Jamaican pizza is ackee and callaloo, or jerk pork, jerk chicken. We also do Hawaiian, pepperoni. So we try to please all kind of buds.
It's a fabulous idea. One, because Devon House has such rich history. And I believe that it's in line with our culture. It's just whatever it is that comes and intertwines together as one. You know, food, culture, music, it's a lifestyle.
I know it's going to be much more exciting. I believe what the Ministry of Tourism have done so far in terms of the improvement on the property is just amazing, and I just know it's going to get better as it goes along. The other retail shops that are here is also a wonderful combination. The atmosphere is great. We love it for Rev Jewelry and Accessories because it lends to the energy and the synergy of what we have to offer. So I'm very happy about this move.
It's an absolutely amazing idea. If we can bring gastronomy and market that as a tourism destination or as a tourism choice, tourist choice rather, that would be amazing.
The thought of persons of, you know, in Jamaica and all that has always been, you know, why is our food not more out there, you know? Why isn't that more people coming just for the food? So, you know, with the minister's vision, it was really about putting that plan into reality.
So happy that the minister has been able to fuse food across the world, Jamaican with Chinese, Jamaican with Italian, Jamaican with Indian, Jamaican with French, any cuisine across the world. We can fuse it with some of our jerk seasoning or some things that are synonymous to Jamaica.
We are particularly happy at this initiative by our minister. The more people that utilize Devon House to come there for different experiences, it means that Devon House will be more self-sufficient in generating funds for the upkeep and maintenance of this heritage site.
When you create a gastronomy center, you know, create an opportunity for not just locals. The locals already understand Devon House, but the tourists that may come, it may attract visitors from the cruise operators, because it's a big deal. And I think it's something that we need to push and drive, because the history and culture of Devon House actually fits very well with the new model, the new proposed model.
Seafood the most, because I'm a seafood lover. Seafood, I think, should be prepared with a lot of pepper.
My favorite jerk pork. Love the pepper, the everything. There's the whole spice to prepare it.
Saltfish, dumpling, yam, banana. Those are the things that I like.
Ackee and saltfish.
Rice and peas. Because I like to taste the coconut milk in there.
Ackee and saltfish. And because it look, when the seasoning in it look more presentable.
Turn corn meal and stewed chicken.
The magazine closes for today, but please visit our social media pages. We're just a click away. You may also download our app to be notified of our latest stories and features. Don't forget to give us a like or leave a comment on our pages. Until next time, I'm Sandra Clark. Take care.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.